Good afternoon. My name is Maxim Shrayer. I'm a professor at Boston College, and I direct the project on Russian and Eurasian Jewry here at Harvard at the Davis Center for Russian and Eurasian Studies. I want to welcome you to this panel on Mikhail Botvinnik. We have two illustrious speakers, and before I introduce them, let me just say that our project is supported by a grant from Genesis Philanthropy Group, and we also enjoy some financial support from the Harvard Center for Jewish Studies, and of course, the ongoing support of the dedicated staff of the Davis Center. This is the fourth and last panel of a series that we launched in the fall and have been having this whole year. It's a series that celebrates contributions of Russian Jews, Jews of the former Russian Empire, Soviet Union and its successive states, also emigres, to history and culture. And as you know, we call it Russian Jews who shaped the world. And just to give you an idea of the kinds of things we've been doing, we had a panel back in the fall on Golda Meir with Pnina Lahav and Sam Casso. We had a panel also in the fall on Vasily Grossman with Alexandra Popov and Boris Lanin. And we recently had a panel on David Oistrakh with Oleg Krysai and Harlow Robinson. And today, we're celebrating the life and legacy of Mikhail Botvinnik, world chess champion, one of the 20th century's dominant chess players and teachers, and also a very important Cold War era Soviet cultural ambassador. And I'm really thrilled to welcome Emil Sutovsky and John Williamson. So sitting on my right is the Russian-Israeli chess player and writer Emil Sutovsky, who is an international grandmaster, the 2001 European chess champion, and 2010 Olympic chess gold medalist. Born in 1977 in Baku, Azerbaijan, Sutovsky lives in Holon, Israel. His love for chess began at the age of four. He gained acclaim with a series of decisive victories, starting with the 1996 Junior Chess Championship held in Medellin, Colombia, followed by the 1997 double round-robin VAM Hoge-Vein tournament and the Hastings 2000. Sutovsky has had a successful Olympiad career, representing Israel in nine chess Olympiads from 1996 to 2018. One of the world's top chess players for the last two decades, Sutovsky is also known as a lecturer and a chess writer. He also met in person nearly all the post-war world chess champions, and I also am very privileged to sit next to such a witness to chess history. His historical essays on chess have appeared in a number of publications worldwide, among them the chess magazine Europe Echec. Recent victories include the 2015 Biel Masters Open Tournament and the 2017 Karpov Tournament in Paikovsky, which is where?
It's in Siberia.
In Siberia, right? Sutovsky was the president of the Association of Chess Professionals from 2012 to 2018 and has been serving as FIDE Director General since 2018. It's really a pleasure to welcome you, Emil, and I am equally thrilled to introduce John Williamson. Like so many chess players of his generation, John Donaldson became fascinated with the game while following the Fischer-Spassky World Championship match played in the summer of 1972, which I vaguely remember as well. I was almost six, and I remember the agitation. Not long after it ended, he joined the Tacoma, Washington Chess Club, where despite a late start, age 14, doesn't seem like a late start to me, but that's what John very modestly said. He made steady progress, earning his National Master and Senior Master titles in 1977 and 79, respectively. He became an International Master in 1983 and currently has two of the needed three norms for the Grandmaster title. For the past 35 years, Donaldson has been a chess professional working as a writer, journalist, coach, and historian of the game, as well as playing. He has served as the U.S. team captain 21 times, including 13 of the biennial chess Olympiads. Highlights include first place finishes in the 1993 World Team Championship and the 2016 Chess Olympiad. Donaldson has served as director of the Mechanics Institute Chess Club of San Francisco. I know some of you are from the chess community, but perhaps others don't know that this is the nation's oldest chess club, and he directed it for 20 years. Donaldson is the author of over 30 books on many aspects of chess, and among his best-known works are biographies of Akiva Rubinstein, Bobby Fischer, and Alexander Alyohin. As you can see, a significant part of Donaldson's work as a chess historian has dealt with chess players of Jewish origin with roots in Russia and Poland. Welcome, John, and it's really kind of you to join our panel.
Thank you.
Before we begin, in the spirit of true Jewish modesty, I have to make a disclaimer, which is I do not particularly feel qualified to moderate this panel. My Jewish genes must have rebelled because I have not inherited even a moderate chess gift. Growing up in what used to be the Soviet Union, I was surrounded by adults playing chess and children who were learning to play chess, family members. At one point, I think when I was about six, the late Grandmaster Lev Pologaevsky, with whom my parents were friendly, was asked to evaluate my chess game, and I was hopeless, completely and totally hopeless. And honestly, my interest in chess was only ignited in college when I started reading Nabokov and Zweig, when I read Zashita Luzhina, The Defense, and the Schach novella, the chess novella by Zweig, and I really started thinking of chess more of as an art form and as a kind of spiritual condition. So I say this because I'm probably going to make a lot of blunders, and I apologize in advance, and I ask for your tolerance. So without further ado, let's turn to the subject, the great Botvinnik, and I'd like to begin by showing you a tiny clip. This is footage of the 1963 World Chess Championship in Moscow. This is very important. This is when Botvinnik loses his title to Tigran Petrosyan after more or less dominating the world chess scene, right, from the late 1940s, correct, into the early 1960s. So this is a very, very tiny clip. That's it. Botvinnik loses, and I think it's a very momentous occasion. And I want to begin with a very generous question. I want to ask both of you, what is the legacy of the great Botvinnik? John, starting with you.
Well, I think there's two sides of it. I mean, one side is Botvinnik, the player, and then there's the other side is Botvinnik, the writer. So I'll leave half of it for Emil. Which half do you prefer? I'll just talk about Botvinnik as the writer. And of all the world champions, with the exception perhaps of Kasparov, I would say he's the most prolific in his writings. And I think that what makes him special is the accessibility of his annotations to the average club player, if you will. Of course, he gives concrete variations. He stated at a very early stage in his development that it was really important that a player always annotate their games properly after they play them, and that you not only do that, but they also publish them so that they could be subjected to peer review, if you will, and you could get feedback from it. And Botvinnik's notes are really special because there's a lot more prose in his commentary than there is for most world champions. And even today, players can read his commentary with benefit. And just to give one concrete example, there's a famous case where he had a very complicated position against Mikhail Tal, and he said, you know, in this position, the right thing to do is to trade one pair of rooks and keep the other pair of rooks on the board. And, you know, it seems kind of like such an overgeneralization for a player of that caliber and level, but Tall said, you know, he analyzed for an hour, he analyzed for 2 hours, and he got a really good feel for the position. He said, you know, Botvinnik really summed things up, and he summed it up very concisely. So I think Botvinnik's chess commentary will remain useful in the future in the way that some of his contemporaries will not.
That's great. Emil, so the legacy of the great Botvinnik.
Well, as for a writer, I can only subscribe to what John just said. I would just add, at the end of 70s, the youngs and end of 60s, sorry, the young Alexander Bilyavsky, who went to be one of the top players in the world, was given a book of Botvinnik to check for the mistakes, and he tried to work on it for a couple of weeks and couldn't find any. So it really stood to the test of time. Definitely his writings were very, very influential. And I think up to the 90s, where the computers popped up, these books which were written in 60s remained dominantly important. As for the player, I think the input was even more valuable because Botvinnik he was in fact the first chess professional. Not only in the way that he earned money with that, because it was not the first thing to do, but the way of his approach. He took it very seriously, from very little detail when you go to sleep, that you don't drink during the tournaments, that your routine includes walking to the round for 15 or 20 minutes to the round, you know, to breath, that you do not analyze the game that same evening, that you can go sleep and relax yourself and not overload yourself with chess, that you try to arrive to the tournament a few days to adjust yourself to accommodate to the local conditions. And of course, in a way, his opening preparation was. Because prior to him, all the players were as talented as they were. This preparation was very much amateurish. They would think about something to play, even if they were playing very strong opponent, and come and play. No, but he tried to build up the whole repertoire to know how he meets all the ideas. He was the first, probably the first, surely the first who did it systematically, let's put it this way, who linked the opening phase and the middle game. So he tried to build entire strategy in advance, especially the openings like English opening, which he favored in the latest years and so on. So he tried to make this connection, to dig deeper and so on. He was very much objective with himself. He knew what are his weaknesses, and although at times he was clearly world number one, he always kept on improving. And actually, first he started publishing his works and working on this weakness in 1930s, and many friends of him told him, Mikhail, but why do you do that? You expose yourself. You show where your weaknesses. And he says, yes, but I also this way I study a lot about myself.
That's great. So maybe this is a good time to just go back in time and talk a little bit about Botvinnik's meteoric rise. So what you should know is that he was born in 1911 outside of St. Petersburg. The circumstances are unusual. So he was born in the Russian Empire, but in the Duchy of Finland within the Russian Empire. So these are exceptional circumstances, not only for Russia's Jews who resided outside of the Pale, but even for children of Jewish parents who were professionals and were able to overcome those restrictions. Now, of course, he comes of age during the early Soviet years, and his rise was phenomenal. And John, I'd like you to tell us a bit about the early Soviet chess scene and his competition. This, by the way, something I was very pleased to find. It's a beautiful sort of cartoon. So Botvinnik wins the 1931 Soviet Chess Championship, and in 33 he repeats it. And this is a whole constellation of chess players. But so what was the scene like, and what was his competition in the early to mid-1930s?
Well, the first thing to keep in mind is that there had always been a rich tradition of chess in Russia preceding the Soviet Union, and Mikhail Chigorin would probably be the best example. So by the early 30s, you had sort of a mixture of players who had developed during the Soviet Union and players like Grigory Levenfish that were strong, you know, really world-class players that had developed prior to that. And by the early 30s, Botvinnik was starting to emerge as the strongest player in the Soviet Union, but he wasn't decisively so. It was only by about the mid-1930s that he was the one, when they had to send a player to Nottingham in 1936, that he finally, you know, and that was something special for the Soviet Union. Before that, they were not sending players outside of the country.
Why is that?
I think because they wanted only one result. They wanted, you know, they wanted somebody who could win. And for the same reason, they didn't send any Olympiad teams till 1952.
And this also, Emil, has probably something to do with the fact that chess was something of a pet project of leading, you know, Bolsheviks who remained in Stalin's circle in 1930, particularly of Krylenko, until he himself was purged, right? He oversaw chess, checkers, and mountain climbing, which I find fascinating.
Yeah, but it's funny because it was indeed a project of Krylenko, who was an influential person who actually was signing, I think, Brest-Litovsk Treaty and so on in 1918. So he was an influential Bolshevik, and he loved chess. And in 1920s, he did huge work to make it happen. And they conducted in 1925 a huge tournament in Moscow with all the top players, with Capablanca. And actually, it was the first time when Capablanca met Botvinnik in a simul display. And Botvinnik won a famous game. He was then 14, and that was a huge, you know, to beat world champion in this way. But Krylenko was really a driving force. He was under Stalin's repression after all, but he was never accused of doing mishandling the chess issue. Actually, mountain climbing was mentioned when he was accused, but chess was never. It was like,
yeah,
it was fascinating. it was very important because this emerging Soviet power, and they realized very quickly that chess could be something that, if they promote, it puts Soviet country on a map, you know, as a country of a bright mind.
So maybe this is a good time to turn to the famous 1938 Botvinnik-Capablanca game. And I'd like you both sort of to explain to us, in layman's terms, if possible, what is it that Botvinnik does so remarkably?
Well, one thing is, from this game you'll find out is that Emil made reference to the fact that Botvinnik developed certain openings. But it wasn't just openings. It was like opening systems and that transition from the opening to the middle game. So here what happened is, although this came from a Nimzo-Indian, the pawn structure could have come from exchange variation of the Queen's Gambit Declined, where White has this mobile center where he tries to play f3 and e3 and then eventually e4. And Botvinnik was very principled when he played. He valued space. And he valued the initiative. And so what's happened in this game is that, on the one hand, black, if you look in this position, if you just count the pawns, is actually a pawn up. And if you look at this position, you'll see also black has a passed pawn on the queen side. So long term, all the trump cards are there for black. But the problem is that the middle game is coming before the end game. And Botvinnik, you know, it's kind of a funny thing when you try to pigeonhole chess players and you try to categorize them like, was he primarily a strategist, or was he primarily a tactician? It's not so easy, because you think of Botvinnik as a strategist. I mean, his development of so many opening systems and strategies. But this game is just one example of what an astute tactician he was. Another good example is his victory over Lajos Portage in the late 1960s in Monaco. But in this game, what he shows is that the black Queen Knight is far from the king side. And so it's the pawn on e6 is so far advanced, it's almost like an extra piece. And so he weaves these elements together, but also you look at that bishop on b2, and often in the structure it looks like it's buried and that it doesn't really play any decisive role. But he found in this game, as it shows at the bottom there, with bishop a3, he's able to drive the black queen away from the king side. And then the black king is basically exposed to a series of forcing moves that results in a lost position.
When you look at this game, what comes to mind?
Well, my main conclusion here is that a concept, it's not, as John put it, not an opening as an entire concept. It is living till this moment. Let's say Kasparov played this way. Also recently, Anand plays this against Carlsen and nearly won. He got winning position, but then he blundered. So this concept outlived not only Botvinnik, it outlived 20th century. It's concept that you push up in the center and you let whatever happens on the queen side, and this initiative which he's seizing in the center and then developing an attack, even not counting pawns and so on. It's something long-term strategies that work in this game, and I saw countless examples of the kind. Mm-hmm. But before Botvinnik, nobody came with a concept like that. I mean, it's an entire concept fundamentally. Perfect. As a final combination, might be not too difficult, but still, I mean, it's very aesthetic. And I remember, I think it was in Leipzig, 1960, that there was some cake in this with this position drawn and so on, yeah, presented. So it is a legendary game. It also from the legendary tournament of 1938, that was the only time till the recent times that 8 best players played in a tournament with a double round robin, and that's the tournament where Botvinnik finally made his claim as the world potentially best player when he shared first, second place with Ruben Fine.
Wow. Fascinating. So as you can see, we are kind of inching our way right to 1948. But before we get there, I know, John, you have written a biography of Alyokhin, and you're a real expert in this field. I was wondering if you could talk a bit about the place of this Russian emigre chess champion and the Soviet plans to defeat. And I think, of course, there's a lot at stake, not just chess, but ideological considerations.
Yeah, I would say from the very early days of the Soviet Union, there was kind of a question of how to deal with those who had left. And some of them, for example, Bogoyubov had been interred in Triberg in Germany during the First World War. And Alyokhin would be another example, and there were even others examples, but those are probably the two most prominent. And I would say that during the history of the Soviet Union, they always had a kind of a difficult relationship with them. On the one hand, they published game collections. There's a very famous game collection by Koto, a very thick book of Alekhine's best games. If you look at, I think there was also a novel or a movie made about Elikin's life, again written by Koto.
He's in the picture.
Yes, right? Yes. And so he always figured in there. But on the other hand, he was alleged to have collaborated with the Nazis during the Second World War. It's true that he and his wife were in France. They were under the German control. It's not completely clear under what conditions it was written, if he wrote it or if he just signed it.
You talk about those kind of
anti-Semitic. Yeah, really. So after the Second World ended, there was a lot of people that were angry with Alekhine, and it wasn't just from the Soviet Union. Ruben Fine, there were many that thought he should be stripped of his title, but Botvinnik didn't want that. He wanted to play a match with him, and I'm pretty confident if they had played a match, he would have won and won decisively, because by that point, Botvinnik was in poor health. You know, he had spent several years in Portugal in rather trying circumstances. So there's no question. I mean, when Botvinnik won the championship in 48, he was the best player in the world.
And yet, Emil, when we were talking in preparation for this panel, I remember the question came up that he was not always in top form. And in fact, in the 1940s, he was not always, winning the championship. And I mean, even this championship where Karas came out ahead and also Lilienthal. And yet, my question is sort of, how does he become the chosen one?
Well, that's a very good question. I think from the very beginning, from the 30s, Botvinnik was a clear leader of a new generation of Soviet players. There was no doubt about it. So he was a one that, let's say, Kremlin or Soviet Union would bet on him, that he would provide it with all the conditions. He would be the only person at that time who would be sent to England with his wife. I mean, now it would sound ridiculous. I mean, what's special? But it was really special. I mean, the guy goes in 1936 to Nottingham, accompanied by his wife, and he comes a week before the tournament to have his time there. And the same with
so in other words, they trusted him that he wouldn't defect.
They trust him very much, and he was very loyal, of course. And but when he grew to prominence, and it was the effect. Even his very presence in this tournament in 1938, we spoke about, was not necessarily forced, because by that time the Soviet champion was Grigory Levinfish, who belonged to the previous generation, and of course they relied on the younger one. And Botvinnik did have all the possible conditions, even World War, during the World War II, he was exempted from the work. He was working as a electrical engineer, but he was allowed twice a week to take the day off to study chess only. He was relocated. He was not in St. Petersburg. Petersburg was under blockade at that time. He was near Sverdlovsk somewhere. And he actually, when the World War was over, he was the one who advanced mostly most of all the other Soviet players. It's true that in 1940, it was not clear yet, let's say, the Soviet Championship 1940 showed that Botvinnik is still rather vulnerable. He shared only fifth place in the Soviet Championship. But then by the end of World War II, he was a clear leader and the strongest player. And in 1946, there was a tournament in Groningen that determined who will be actually fighting in 1948 for the title. And Botvinnik emerged first ahead of Max from Holland. And another Russian player, Vasily Smyslov, was third. So by 1948, when they went to this tournament, match tournament, which brought a victory to Botvinnik and the title, he was a clear favorite, although a player like Paul Keres, we haven't named him yet, who...
He was just in the photo. Oh, here he is too, right.
Right, yeah. So it's a younger, it's probably from 1946 or something like that, or 47, because...
This is 47. This
right.
is Chigorin.
Chigorin Memorial. That's very important. I'll tell you one thing about this game. This game is not usually skipped. I don't know if you know the story about this game. 1947, and Botvinnik writes in his diaries that I faced Keres. And of course, it's not about this tournament or this particular game. But I'm going to play next year in 1948, and I have to inflict a victory, you know, to gain an upper hand towards the World Championship match. So it was 1 year before the match, this match tournament took place, but already for Botvinnik it was very critical to have a dominant, you know, a leader position. So he won this game, and actually later on he went on to beat Keres 4-1 in this match. They're saying that Keres was under an impact of, you know, Soviet influence, not to play his best chesses in this tournament.
I've heard that as well.
Till now,
Till now,
nobody knows. It is true that Keres did play under Nazis in the tournaments. Keres was a real gentleman, and when everyone asks who was the most, you know, prominent figure in chess in terms of personality, many people would say Keres, and even Korchnoi, who wouldn't like any person in chess world and would have a bitter relationship with most of them, or at least some something like that. The only person he would really admire would Keres. So, but Keres still played. He was Estonian, and for him, Soviets were not necessarily the best friends, neither Russians.
Of course, here they both appear as Soviet grandmasters. Yeah, but I think there's a little bit of irony behind this.
Yeah, Keres only joined the Soviet family in 1940 when Estonia was occupied by Soviet.
Right.
And he started playing in tournaments. Later on, Keres was under serious threat to end up somewhere in Siberia, but somebody stepped in and protected him, and he played as a prominent Soviet player.
Good. Well, maybe this is a good time to speak finally about 1948. Emil, you mentioned Botvinnik. If you don't mind, can we do that after we're done with the panel? We'll have about half an hour for questions. So I was going to say, Emil, as you pointed out, he had this really official status here in this photograph. He's with the Soviet ambassador, as you can see. This is The Hague. The championship is played in two stages, first in The Hague and then in Moscow, right? There is also, this is a very interesting period piece, right? The battle for world championship. Here, as you can see, there is an American chariot. And who is in the chariot?
Sammy Reshevsky.
Exactly. And then look who is representing the Soviet Union. I think this is fascinating. This is Botvinnik, Keres, and Young Smyslov, right?
Yes.
So in other words, even within the Soviet context, the minorities are clearly overrepresented. Estonians and Jews, and part Jews, part Slavs.
Well, I can tell you a story about that. That's a funny one, actually. You reminded me. There was a shortage TV video shortage from 1960 or 62. Telling about a variety of representatives of Soviet Union in Soviet Olympic teams that just won an Olympiad. And they were filming and telling like that Soviet players are represented by Armenian Petrosyan, Estonian Keres, and Mikhail Tal from Riga.
That's right.
So, because he was a Jewish, he would even say, you know. So it was this way. Actually, Soviet chess scene was very much influenced by Jewish, if not say dominantly. It was like, I would estimate it about 60% of the top players.
I'll actually have a slide which presents this. So basically, the championship, and John, I wonder if you could talk a bit more about Botvinnik's victory
Well, it was quite decisive because, you know, Emil alluded to the speculation about whether Karas was forced to basically, you know, give points to Botvinnik. But it's clear that even if you take their individual result out, Botvinnik was still winning the event. So it was pretty decisive. I would say that that tournament, you know, he had to win it, so he won it. But if you go back to that 1940 Soviet championship, he didn't win it, but the next year they organized the absolute championship of the Soviet Union, and he won it. And that would become kind of the hallmark of his career, was his ability to win the revenge match. And he did that several times during his world championship reign against Smyslov, against Tall, and he was very bitter. He was not offered that opportunity against.
And also, I wanted to ask you, John. You mentioned earlier when we spoke the 1954 chess Olympian in Amsterdam, and that you pointed out that 2 years prior to that, at the 1952 Olympiad in Helsinki, Botvinnik was left out, right? And he was the ranking world champion.
He was, and you might wonder, how is it possible that the world champion wouldn't play on the Olympiad team? And he went to the training camp. You'll have to pardon my pronunciation, but I think the term they have is a zbori. And it's a time-honored tradition in the Soviet Union before important sporting competitions. They would have them go to like a sanitarium, and they would do sports, and they would eat well and healthily, and they would receive psychological preparation. They would do technical chess preparation, and finally they would just sort of recharge their batteries. And during the course of the preparation for the 1952 Olympiad, they played training games amongst the candidates for the team. And Botvinnik had a hard time during these training games, and he was actually voted off the team. And I think one thing to keep in perspective is probably being, you know, world champion, he either was going to play on first board or he's going to play on no board. Mm-hmm. Because you don't ask the world champion to play the second board. And the thing also is this is the first time the Soviet Union competed in a chess Olympiad. They didn't play in Dubrovnik for political reasons 2 years earlier because of the rift between Stalin and Tito. So in selecting this team, they would realize they're a prohibitive favorite to win the event. I mean, they have six players on their team, four players playing regularly and two players as reserves. And the fact is that their reserve players were good enough to play the top board for pretty much any team. But there were a few Western players that were world class. Ryshevsky would be one, Gligorich from Yugoslavia would be a second, and Nidor from Argentina would probably be the other main threat. So I think the key thing was that the Soviets looking at the situation was they're going to win the Olympiad, and whoever's going to play on board one, if it's Botvinnik, you know, he's going to have a good result. Well, they decided that he wouldn't play on the team, and Botvinnik was furious, really furious. And later in the year, he got his revenge, his first revenge, shall we say, by winning the Soviet championship. But then later, in 1954, and I should say, by the way, that 52 Olympiad, despite having, you know, six of the top 10 players in the world, arguably, they won by 1.5 points over Argentina over the course of a very long tournament. Not what you would expect them to do, and much too close for comfort. In 1954, and by the way, Karas lost two games on board one and had a miserable performance. I'm sure Botvinnik was happy the Soviet Union won, but he probably was not unhappy that he won by a small margin and that Karas had a poor result. In 54, he's back, has a brilliant tournament on board one, doesn't lose a game, and the Soviet team wins by 7 points.
Fabulous. So maybe this would be a good time to talk about some rivalry, not only on the international chess scene, but within the Soviet chess scene. And I'm particularly curious, Emil, to hear your comments about the Botvinnik-Smyslov camps. I remember growing up, and people would draw a parallel, just as in on the Soviet opera scene, there are those who are fanatics of Lemishev, and then those who have Kozlovsky, two dominant opera male singers. And they would say there are you know, those who are in the Smyslov camp and then the Botvinnik camp. So,
well, if we put it this way, Lemeshev and Kozlovsky, I would rather refer to Botvinnik and Tal rather than Botvinnik and Smyslov. Botvinnik and Smyslov had much more things in common, both in chess-wise and generation-wise. So, but in general, Botvinnik was respected by everyone, but hardly liked by many. Especially among chess players, he didn't make a lot of friends. He always had his special position in chess, both treated very favorably by government, and also, you know, presenting himself as a patriarch, which he was in a way. And that didn't make him a lot of friends. He was doing a lot for chess in the country as well, but he was a very much a person who would believe in something and would follow it categorically and would not see other, you know, would not counter other opinions. And that led not only to the chess sport rivalry with like I said, with Smyslov or later Petrosian or Natal, but rather that they were simply were not in friendly terms. And when they were team or something, there were known cases when even he mistrusted to his own seconds. Let's say during the match, there was a famous case when Salo Flor, his helper, was analyzing entire night some move which Botvinnik allegedly sealed when it was the time of sealing moves and then playing them. And then on the next day, he learned that Botvinnik in fact sealed different move and he just didn't acknowledge it and led Flor to make just his work for nothing just because of this sort of mistrust. And it was his own second, once again, the one he picked himself to help.
Yeah.
So you can call it an hysteria, which is in a way can be attributed to the Stalin times and so on, but in a way it also was a Botvinnik as a personality. So he was a complex person, mm-hmm. and there was definitely a rivalry. He wasn't known for making a lot of bad things for his rivals, not much or not famous for that at least, but definitely he wouldn't be a very good comrade to his team members or something.
No, from what I understand, in fact, we were talking about this yesterday. In the he refused to sign the letter announcing Korchnoi, and I think that speaks very highly of him. Is that your sense as well?
Yeah, he was a very principled person. I mean, even after the Soviet Union collapsed, he was still a true believer in the communist system. He was Russian by culture. Jewish ethnically, but in terms of his political allegiance, there's no question. He was a Soviet. He was a Soviet man, and Emil alluded to the fact that he didn't trust his seconds. He didn't even trust the wall boys. There would be a demonstration boards that were being going alongside the regular game, and the game would be replayed, and he didn't want any strong players manning those demonstration boards on the obscure and highly unlikely chance that the demo board player would somehow make a clue, you know, for example, in the match Fischer-Taimanov, future Grandmaster Peter Biasis was one of the wall boys. And when when Fischer captured one of Taimanov's pieces, Biasis made the recapture before it was played on the board. Now, it was an obvious automatic recapture. Failure to do so, Fischer could have just resigned. But Fischer looked at him like, you just don't do that. And I'm afraid Botvinnik would have probably like just hanged the guy for committing such an offense.
Right. Since we're on the subject of Fischer, I think it's so wonderful to have you here. In connection with Fischer, you wrote a biography of his, which is very well known. We have here a famous slide from Varna from 1962. We also have a little clip, which I'd like to play. This is something that John called the patriarch smile. This is the very end of the match, and you'll see what happens here. Oh, excuse me. Watch carefully. There. That's what you were referring to, right? Which I think is a fabulous moment. So talk to us about that.
Well, you think of Botvinnik and Fischer, there's three moments where they intersect. The first is in 1958. After Fischer appeared on the show, I've Got a Secret, and nobody could guess his secret, which was so that he was U.S. champion, he got a plane ticket. And the plane ticket allowed him to fly to the interzonal in Porto Rose, but he also could make stopovers, since it was on Sabena Airlines, the Belgian national carrier. He could stop in Brussels and in Moscow, and he did both. And he was accompanied by his sister on those legs of the trip. And his sister, who, by the way, was born in the Soviet Union when Fischer's mother, Regina, was studying medicine there. And so it was that Fischer arrived with his sister in Moscow in the summer of 1958. And the Soviets thought, well, we'll show him, you know, he'll do a little bit of chess, and then we're going to show him the Bolshoi, we're going to show him the zoo, we're going to take him on all these cultural activities, and we'll put him on the plane and off he'll go. But that wasn't Bobby's idea. He parked himself at the Moscow Central Chess Club, and he just wanted to play blitz all day and all of the night. And we have a couple, there's a famous picture of Fischer playing against Petrosian there, and with some very famous names in the crowd. And we also know from recollections of Vasyukov, who played Fischer, and from Kazich, who was the commentator, or excuse me, was the tournament director of the Taimanov Fischer match. He, at that dinner that he and Fischer had, that where Vasyukov had been seconding Taimanov, they shared some memories of that, which are also written. But the long and short of it is that Fischer, against minor Soviet masters, he was crushing them left and right. He called out, well, where's Botvinnik? You know, he should come down to the club and I should play him some blitz. There was about as much chance of Fischer playing blitz with Botvinnik as there was of him, you know, going to Mars. It just wasn't going to happen. There would be absolutely no upside for Botvinnik, and he didn't play much, if any, blitz at all. And then also Bronstein, you know, why not Bronstein? But Bronstein, you know, he was just a few years removed from drawing a match for a world championship. Again, you know, Fischer was not yet Fischer. It would have not going to happen. Instead, it ended up Vasyukov and Petrosian. And Vasyukov, maybe some of you probably don't know, because he wasn't so famous. Only the very elite of the Soviet chess could go out and play regularly in Western Europe. And he didn't have that opportunity until the 1970s. But he was very, very strong, you know, winner of Moscow Championship on several occasions, and very high-quality grandmaster. So there's some differing accounts. I mean, Fischer remembers he was winning most of the games. Vasyukov remembers it a little differently. That's not untypical for chess masters. Petrosian, though, the one thing there's no doubt, Petrosian was a, you know, really phenomenally gifted blitz player, and he was a very strong player already, and he quieted Bobby down. So that was the first interaction Bobby had. That was a very important interaction, because there's a postcard that's at the Lilly Library in Bloomington, Indiana, and this postcard was sent by Bobby Fischer to John Collins at the time that Fischer was there. And it basically just says, you know, I wanted to stay longer, I wanted to play against these guys, but these commies, you know, are sending me off. And Fischer, up to that point, his relations with the Soviet Union were more or less positive, but he wasn't that strong a player yet. But after that, his relations with the Soviet officialdom, you know, the Chess Federation and things, was quite poor. Individual Soviet players he could have warm relations with, you know, analyzing games and such forth afterward, or playing blitz with him. But as far as his relationships with the Soviet chess authorities, like, they were like the enemy. And so it was in 1962, you have Botvinnik, who is still at that point the world champion, who is playing board one, and who is, you know, the standard bearer for Soviet chess. And here he's playing against Fischer, and he's playing with the white pieces. And he played a variation into Fischer's Grunfeld, and he had prepared this line, but he had made a mistake. Fischer refuted over the board. Fischer got a considerable advantage, probably a winning decisive advantage, but he spoiled it in the last part of the first time control. If the game had continued to a second time control, as is the norm now where they play to a finish, perhaps he might still have won the game, but the game was adjourned. And Fischer now was not just competing against Botvinnik, he was competing against everybody on that Soviet team, and it was Geller, one of Fischer's hardest opponents during his career, who Botvinnik owed a big favor to after he found a saving resource. And when we saw that smile there, Botvinnik, who had been sweating for most of the game, finally, had escaped, from near certain death. And so, Fischer in 60 memorable games said that, Botvinnik was puffed his chest up like a rooster, and he was very, very proud. He'd saved this game. So this is the only time these two players ever met. But in 1970, they were trying to arrange a match in Leiden, in the Netherlands, between the two of them, and it got far enough along that Botvinnik studied Fischer's games very seriously, and he ended up sharing that information with Taimanov for his preparation when he played Fischer a year later. Not that it helped Taimanov; he lost every single game. But you might think by 1970, Botvinnik was like an old man, and he was no longer a strong player, and it would have been very one-sided. But Vinnick, he didn't get a chance to defend his title in 63, and he did not play regularly after that, but he still played very well.
And that was because the regulations changed, right?
Yes, correct.
So in other words, he might have still continued to dominate.
Petrosian would have been the most difficult for him to win a revenge match.
Well, I don't think he would get a revenge in 1964. He lost the match in 1963, very much one-sided match against Petrosian, and Petrosian was a player very difficult to face. I mean, from a style, his style was unpleasant to face for Botvinnik. Uh-huh. And let's not forget, by 1963, he was already 52. And it would not be easy to reshape himself. But who knows? I would just refer to that story about the game with Fischer, because a very nice story that remained behind the scene, but it's also very telling about the chess at that time, the Soviet chess. Mikhail Tal, another Soviet world champion, recollects that the game was adjourned, and actually Fischer opines that it's still very, very, very easy win for him, because he was also under illusion, because previously the game was very, very easy win. Today, I think most of the players would have resigned on Botvinnik's place. But anyways, it continued, and then Fischer blundered and was adjourned, and then they was trying to find some ideas, and still it didn't work. And Tal recollects, our entire team, which means six players and two trainers, was working, and we split in order to work effectively. And me and Spassky, he writes, me and Spassky, two young guys, and by that time Tal already was ex-world champion, two young guys were running between the floors to deliver and to exchange latest information, because he was 25 at the time, 26, and Spassky 25. So there were two youngest guys who were running and exchanging information. And finally, Geller, another Jewish guy, actually, Botvinnik smiled to Geller. When we saw him smiling, he turns up, and Geller stands behind him on this video. Geller found a very unusual idea. By that time, it was revolutionary. Today, it's very much of a common to allow two connected pawn to run, and still it is a draw for some reason. But really, this was a mess, but that also shows you a way why Soviet chess was dominant for a lot of time. Even with all these rivalries, there was always a constant exchange of ideas and of analysis and so on. And that was not something that Western players could allow. They simply wouldn't have enough players of such a caliber to exchange
ideas. That's great. And I want to go back to the point, Emil, you made earlier, and also, John, you touched on this, which sort of brings together, on the one hand, the sense of Soviet chess as a Cold War ideological battleground, right? And on the other hand, I mean, if you look here, so basically after World War II, throughout the Soviet decades, the only non-Soviet chess champion is Bobby Fischer. The others are all Soviet players. But once you start looking beyond the very, very, inclusive category and look at the players themselves, another, I think, fascinating tension emerges that The, of course, Emilia, as you pointed out, the Jewish element clearly dominates. I just want to mention something. Vasily Aksionov, very important Soviet writer, whose mother was Jewish and whose father was not, and was very attuned to these questions. In 1965, so the thaw had already come to an end, but he managed to publish a story called Victory, which is about a grandmaster who is unnamed, who is in a train compartment, and he's forced by the Soviet everyman to play chess, and he ends up losing to him. But in the exchange that they have, the Soviet everyman says to him, you know, basically, I wonder why all chess players are Jews. And the grandmaster, who may or may not be Jewish, we don't know, he basically says, well, not all of them. For instance, I am not, right? So in other words, I'd like you, Emil, and also you, John, to sort of talk about this paradox of how the Jewish element dominates, but also minorities are dominating on the chess scene. Jews, Estonians, Armenians, how that story presents itself to us today.
Well, I think it's a topic for a separate discussion generally, because it's something that could be analyzed properly. It's true that the percentage of Jews in Soviet chess and in world chess was very, very high in 19th and 20th century. Let's not be conclusive about the Soviet chess, even if we take international chess, the first world champion, William Steinitz or Zen Lasker, and actually most of the top players at the beginning of the 20th century, like Akiba Rubinstein, for example. So it was in a way, maybe it has some links to Jewish tradition, to studying Torah and so on. We don't know. What happened in Soviet chess later on, that it went to this way that from one side there was a strong Jewish presence, especially there was Moscow, St. Petersburg, and Ukraine. These are three regions. But there were also local heroes in the republics. Let's say Petrosyan, he's Armenian. He grew up in Georgia, actually, in Tbilisi. Then he moved into Moscow.
There's a whole Armenian neighborhood.
Yeah. And he lived in this Armenian neighborhood, right. And Keres is Estonian also for the small nation. So it's not my case. I mean, why did it happen precisely that the Soviet chess scene was represented this way? We could think about various reasons, from a tradition which came from years earlier and generations earlier that could be explained this way, and B, because maybe it was very, very respected profession in Soviet Union. So like today, you wouldn't have many Jews on the chess scene. And I have discussed...
Today you wouldn't have many Jews on the cultural scene in general, as my research recently showed.
My idea is as follows. It's probably that Jewish parents that had a good tradition of trying to educate their kids to the maximum level would switch their interest to another fields like economics or advocates, right, and so on. So chess, which was a prominent part of, you know, very, very prestigious thing back in Soviet Union, especially in that time, you could have person traveling outside of Soviet Union, which nobody had, you would get a very decent stipend and a lot of, you know, incomes like simultaneous displays, lectures, and so on. You would get duchess and so in Soviet Union, if you were a chess grandmaster, your income would be like a very good professor, but your status would be even higher. Your status would be, I mean, anything below that minister of a government would be below you, I think. It would be very, very high status, really. You would be recognizable at every place.
Right. Well, that means, of course, in broad terms, that by the 1970s, with the rise of Jewish emigration from the Soviet Union, the Jewish chess players, the Jewish grandmasters who represent the Soviet Union, in a sense, they are very contrary to the trend in many, many ways. And also, they reach the very top of the society that now openly resists their success. So I think there's a lot at stake. I mean, probably it's not Botvinnik's story, but the story of the generation that follows.
Botvinnik was a very, very, very Soviet person. I mean, he if you ask, he wouldn't even regard himself as Jewish. I mean, he says that he has a Jewish blood, of course, but he was a very much Soviet person.
Right.
I mean, he was Soviet. Let's say. Fischer always regarded to all Soviet players as Russians, or regarded to all Russians as Soviets, but he didn't distinguish. But they were Russians, they were Soviets, they were Jews, but Botvinnik was definitely the one player you would call a Soviet player.
Right.
Even Mikhail Fal, you wouldn't call him Soviet. He would call him, you could call him anyways. But Botvinnik was first of all Soviet person.
Yeah, wonderful. So before we open up the floor, and we'll have some time for questions, I would love to hear a little bit about two things. One, sort of Botvinnik's important career as an electrical engineer and a researcher, and also as a pioneer of computer chess, and also Botvinnik as a teacher of many great chess players. So maybe, John, you could take up the first and Emil the second, and then we'll take questions.
So Botvinnik, throughout his life, he never was 100% a chess player all the time. To put that in perspective, yes, when he was playing world championships, when he was preparing for them, for important competitions, then chess was front and center. But at other points in his life, from the 1950s on, he was trained as an electrical engineer, and he started to become interested in the idea of developing a chess computer program that could play chess and could play intelligently. And so he did this for several decades, and he worked on the theory that he wanted a machine that would be able to learn, that would think like a human being, and that would, you know, gradually get stronger and stronger. Now, for he died in 1995, so he did not quite yet live to see the day when the computers would get stronger than the strongest grandmaster, but he saw during his life a tremendous jump from like a complete potzer beginner to a very strong grandmaster. And in fact, the only time he came to the United States, he did not play in the match USA-USSR in 1954, but he did come in 1983 to the World Computer Championship in New York, the only time he was ever in the US. And he was an honored guest at that event. And there's a famous photo on the cover of Chess Life with him and his old rivals, Rushevsky and Fine. So he played a large role, but of course, the model that he developed, the chess computer that would learn from its mistakes and would think like a human being, that's not ultimately the way that chess computers went. They went in a different direction, and the increased computing power led in a different direction. So his aim wasn't realized, but still he played, you know, a role in, you know, the development of computer chess. But I think it's a lesser role than his role as a player or as a writer.
Perfect. And Botvinnik as a teacher of great chess players. By the way, look at how Kasparov is dressed in this photograph. I think it's such a marvelous, marvelous example of Soviet fashion.
Yes. Right?
Yeah, it's a funny one. Actually, Botvinnik was a great teacher. It was two generations of players he was guiding. First generation was first attempt to create Botvinnik school. It was immediately after he stopped playing at the beginning of 70s. And to this generation belonged Anatoly Karpov, who was a member of his school, and Yuri Balashov, who was a member of his school, I think Irina Levitina, and so on. I believe that this lasted for just a couple of years, or even a bit less. And then, already after the perestroika started, he merged with, then it was in 1970s, when Kasparov was here, and that was a school which was more successful also, with Kasparov. Anak Sharumov was a Soviet champion and later American champion. He and Kasparov kept being in very strong ties throughout Kasparov's career till they broke up in 1988, I think. There was some dispute, and Kasparov didn't respect Botvinnik enough, and they split in 1980. After 1988, they were not very much in touch. But Kasparov respected him very much, not as a legendary person, but somebody who can really provide a good advice. Let's say during his match in 1983 against Korchnoi, he spoke regularly with Botvinnik, and Kasparov recollects that before game six in London, Kasparov was trailing 3-2, Korchnoi was ahead, and suddenly there was a phone call from Moscow, or from St. Petersburg, from Moscow, I think, most likely, and he heard Botvinnik speaking, and he said, "Garry, do you remember what happened precisely 50 years ago?" And Kasparov says, "Well, 1933, what must have been? Oh, you played a match against Salo Flor. Right, do you remember what was the score after five games Kasparov had to. Okay, you were trailing 1 point. Yes, and do you remember how the match finished? Okay, and so he was supported by Botvinnik, and also Botvinnik won important trade as well. During the matches with Karpov, Botvinnik was clear on the side of Kasparov. Karpov was very much pro-Soviet, you know, prominent Soviet champion, but still Botvinnik supported Kasparov, supported openly, supported also helped him during the match with advices. Of course, he was already a retired player and couldn't do a lot of chess advices, but some general strategy and approach, so he would do so. And later on, when Kasparov became a champion in 1985, and then already in 1985 or 86, the Botvinnik-Kasparov chess school started to function. And for 3 years, the best Soviet players attended this, juniors attended this school, and once again, Botvinnik was very much for useful advisors and so on. Some of the advisors were dated, but the general approach shows you that he was already very old by that standards, and he was not a player for already like 15, 17 years or something like that, but his approach, his knowledge, his understanding of chess was very much on request. So his role as a teacher was huge. He was not a personal trainer to any player. He never was attached, but he always was helping younger generations. And as it was at that time, he was, and it's important to state, he was not getting money for that. I mean, it was either very symbolical for him or nothing at all. Right. He did it because he simply felt that he should give this contribution to Soviet chess to develop new talents and so on. And it was very much Botvinnik's, you know. It was typical Botvinnik to go and to have this responsibility to lay the foundation for the next generation of Soviet players.
Wonderful. I think this is a great moment for us to take questions. I would just like for you to wait for the mic because, and I know, sir, you'll be the first to ask. You know, the problem is that the others may not hear you. You hear yourself very well. So, so maybe let's take this question here and then we'll take that question. Is that all right?
I don't need a mic, okay? I have two quick questions. One is the Avro tournament that you spoke of carries in Rubinfein tied for first. Now, my question is, had Rubinfein not sort of resigned himself to no more chess, could he have actually been a contender for the world championship? The second question is more of a controversial one. The Botvinnik-Bronstein match, people have said that Bronstein was forced to throw the match by drawing it, and of course, Botvinnik retains his title. Do you people have any insights into those?
Just to make sure, did you all hear the question? Okay. Good, very good.
So
of course,
I'd go with 1938. Yeah, I just referred to it as Botvinnik shared. Of course, Karras and Fine shared 1938 victory, and Botvinnik was third. I think for Fine, it was a very short period from 36 to 38 when he was really a top player, a very top player. And the very fact that he decided to step out, I think it indicates that he was not capable for fighting for world championship title. Because as I see it, your chess prominence is not only on your chess ability or chess talent, but the way to withstand this pressure and the will to win it. And probably Fine didn't have this overwhelming will to go for a title. And without this will, you would never win a title because the competition is too difficult. So I feel that part of the reason why Fine stopped playing, it was this enormous pressure on this top level, and he probably couldn't withstand. Also, in this very tournament, if you remember, Fine was leading all the way, so he could even take it alone, but he didn't withstand the pressure, and at the end, he shared it with Karras.
Maybe, John, do you want to take up the Bronstein question?
Sure.
It
but
comes up all the time.
Yes, but I will add one last thing to the situation with Ruben Fine. In 1971, he published a booklet after the match, Fischer versus Petrosian, and the match booklet was advertised in the U.S. Chess Federation magazine, and I remember it. It was like, this is a match, and there would be a picture of Petrosian, of the man who was world champion. Then there was a picture of Fischer, and this is the man who will be world champion. And there was a picture of Fine, and this is the man who should have been world champion. But this is so Fine engaged in a lot of sort of, you know, revisionist sort of chess history. I would concur with Emil's assessment that he was a great player, but certainly by 1948 he was not going to be, you know, one of the top 5-6 players in the world. As far as the match between Botvinnik and Bronstein, there's no question that it was a very hard-fought match. That it was Bronstein was a very creative player, particularly then. You know, he was like one of the fathers of the King's Indian defense. He created a lot of problems for Botvinnik. But while he might have had the edge as a creative player with lots of new interesting ideas, Botvinnik was the better positional player, the better technician, and the better endgame player. And the latter proved to be Bronstein's Achilles heel near the end of the match. Now, there are always whispers, as there are whispers after 1948, that, you know, Karas was forced to dump these games and stuff. But, you know, and Bronstein sort of like made, he alleged, he never spoke directly about it, but kind of around the corners, he kind of raised the specter that, you know, he was, you know, kind of persuaded that maybe him being, you know, Soviet Jew, that wasn't a high-ranking party member, maybe it wasn't a healthy thing for him to be world champion. But I don't find any existing, you know, smoking gun that proves that to be the case. And certainly after that, Bronstein was still a world-class player for the next decade. You know, I mean, that he would play in Soviet Olympic teams and such. But he was never a contender. You know, he never got back to where he'd play a match for the title.
Just if I may add, I would explicitly say no. There was no pressure of the kind on Bronstein. Yes, he claims that his father was still in the camps and it could impact him or so on, and it probably did, but no direct order, because Bronstein spoke very openly about the things happening in Soviet chess in 1990s already when he was alive, but he never came up with an accusation, even when Botvinnik passed away, that he was forced to lose. The only evidence is something like he mentioned, hinted to Fischer that I was made to lose, but it was just a speculation. And one more thing, I have been recently speaking to the only evidence probably to that story is to Yakov Neistat, who is 96 today, and hope he'll live according to Jewish tradition to 120. And he spoke about Bronstein in a way that he was coming up with a lot of things which were, let's say, not confirmed by facts. So in this case, I'm sure, I'm absolutely sure that there was nothing of a pressure on Bronstein to lose or to draw this match.
Right. So, I'm sorry, sir, I'm going to have to stop you for a minute because we have other people who would like to ask questions. I'm sorry, please.
Thank you for an engaging panel. I wondered if I could just ask both of your thoughts as players and historians on the fact that Botvinnik had the right to re-challenge for the world championship a year after losing it. And I think Petrosyan mentions in one of his books that it was actually kind of ridiculous that you had to beat the world champion twice in order to secure the title, especially since during that year, the loser would be training very hard and intently while the winner would be kind of doing outreach work and being world champion. I had always assumed this was something Botvinnik was able to enforce because of the political security he enjoyed within the Soviet system, and it seems a shame that the chess world lost out on many interesting world championship matchups. And I just wonder what the feeling is about that, if it was fair or unfair. Any thoughts on that?
Thank you. Wonderful question.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, when you looked at the list that was up earlier of all the world champions, you'll notice that Botvinnik, with the exception of Alekhine, was the only world champion who regained his title. And he, I won't say did on a regular basis, but he did it several times. And if you look at Smyslov, he was unlucky, you could say, in the way that the matches were arranged. You know, he drew the first match, so no title there. He won the second match. And then immediately, you know, he got to, you know, to enjoy less than a year probably as a title holder, and then lost the third match. And it's not for nothing that it's very seldom that somebody like loses the world title in a match and then works their way through the system. Spassky was remarkable in that he lost that match to Petrosian the first time out, and then had to go through the candidate cycle all over again to get that return match, and then he won it. So it was a pretty, I mean, I don't see a compelling reason why the world champion should have that extra special favor, if you will. But I will add one thing, since we alluded to 1948 and the possible conspiracy, and we mentioned Bronstein and you know, also this thing. But there's a third one, and I wouldn't call it a conspiracy. I would just call it unfortunate luck. And I don't know if the timing all adds up, but I know that Smyslov, when he married, his wife had a son from her previous marriage. And he was a chess player, and his name was Vladimir Sulemanov. And he was a very promising young player, promising enough that in 1958, he played in the World Junior Championship, maybe it was 57, he played in 57, in the World Junior Championship in Toronto. And it was the World Junior Championship that was won by Lombardi. And he, for whatever reason, he had problems with his travel, and he came several days late, and he had to make up some games. Didn't do particularly well. It wasn't the strongest World Junior. It was 12 player round robin, I think, and Sulemanov finished like fourth, I believe. During that tournament, there's two accounts. One is that he just had a poor result. The other is that he met a young lady when he was in Toronto, and he wanted to get married. And this is a version that's offered by Lombardi in his book that he wrote a few years ago. And that he was advised he should go back to the Soviet Union, he should get permission, and then they could arrange, you know, for this marriage to happen. Well, he didn't stay in Toronto. The marriage did not happen. And a few years later, he killed himself. Those things we know. Whether this added any extra pressure to Smyslov, you know, because, you know, he was either world champion or he was challenger when his stepson came to him and asked him for, you know, to help him. But the fact is, in the late 1950s, I don't think there was any way that Smyslov would have had enough power or influence to make that possible. And so it's a very sad story. But, you know, Smyslov and Botvinnik played three matches. They played more or less evenly in those three matches, and they were more or less, you know, Smyslov was a great player in the 1950s. He won the interzonals, you know, just tremendous player. But I wouldn't necessarily say he was better than Botvinnik. The matches showed they were pretty equally balanced. But to summarize your question, I think those return matches, I mean, they weren't called return matches by Vinnick. They were called revenge matches.
And by the way, you know, after Smyslov's victory, a documentary was quickly made in Soviet Union. And the tone of it favors it. I just watched it. But his stepson appears there.
Yes.
They refer to him as his son, and they say that he is one of the most, of the great hopefuls of Soviet chess.
If you go on, it's on British Pathé.
Exactly.
And it's really, it's only 2 minutes, but I really strongly recommend viewing it. You see Smyslov singing.
Playing the piano.
And they're in the home, and, the relationship between them seems to be very warm, and it's a real tragedy that, that I'm sure Smyslov and his wife had to bear for much of their life.
Emil, I wonder if you want to weigh in on that, just sort of, we could put this to bed. Yeah.
Well, I can just add that, of course, this personal tragedy had impact on Smyslov, and it was more than just a stepson. I think it was in between being son and stepson, because Smyslov had a break as a top player in these years. Mm-hmm. If you take a look at his career, 1960s are poor years for Smyslov, and that exactly after this this story happened. Definitely, as the question you ask, it's absolutely ridiculous, this rematch. From today's perspective, it's absolutely ridiculous. But Vinnick was very much in power to enforce it, and also he believed it's a correct way to proceed, you know, because you can be in a poor form, as he explained, or be unhealthy, and to lose a world title for this reason, it cannot happen. So you should have a chance to prove yourself. So also, Botvinnik never won a match as a world champion. That's a curious thing. He never won a single match as a world champion. He only won these rematches, and he won the 48 match tournament, but never as a champion. So in general, even today, the practice, then after Botvinnik, there was a rule that if match ends in a draw, then champion retains the title. Today, practice even suggests that if a match is a draw, there is a tiebreak. So less and less privileges for the world champion, and the natural result.
Wonderful. We are sadly out of time, and I just want to thank Emil Sutovsky and John Donaldson for being with us for celebrating Mikhail Botvinnik's career. And we hope to see you next year for our events. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.